Now we talk about Vygotsky. Vygotsky is a theorist, not counter to Piaget, but from a different point of view. Piaget is looking really at the individual and the individual's cognitive abilities progressing through their maturation, right? The ability for them to think. Vygotsky is looking at the child as developing in a context, particularly in a social context. The kid is not an island. As we all now well know, hopefully in this class, you know, everybody has a worldview that depends very greatly on where they happen to have been born in the world and what time in the world's history they happen to have been born. What information is available, what information is valued, what information is taught becomes the predominant worldview of any individual. Unless it's challenged, it kind of remains that way by default. So where is that coming from? Well, it's coming from society. Society matters. Kids try to construe meaning from society. They will do that with directive interaction. They get meaning originally because I say, don't touch that. Yes, touch that. Put on your shoes. I tell you what to do. I reinforce and reward you for certain things that you should do and punish you or try to inhibit you from doing things you shouldn't do. You get a lot of directed interaction. Parents telling kids what's okay and what's not okay. Smile, camera, smile. Oh, okay. That's a directive action. You did it because I told you to do it, not because you spontaneously did it necessarily, right? So then we got kids starting to move away into their own worlds. As they develop cognitively, they start being able to represent the world internally, and then you see them playing around. And what do they play? They play like adults, don't they? They got their dolls and their action figures. They might have a mommy or a daddy or a teacher or a friend or whomever's in their actual social world playing out little roles where they're trying to work out meaning for themselves. And at that point, they engage in private speech. So if you sneak up on a kid and you watch them around the corner, you'll oftentimes hear them talking to themselves, right? They don't just sit there silently going, They say, hi, how are you doing? Oh, I'm fine, how are you? And they're actually acting it out. For Vygotsky, that means they're actively making meaning, understanding relationships, and they're speaking it out loud because they've learned to speak. But then, as they progress and get older, that outward speech moves to inner speech. Everybody talks to themselves. In fact, if you think about how you think, it's largely language-based, right? It's not necessary. Some people think in images. But if I said, how do you get to pals? Most people would run through a script in their mind, like an actual verbal script. Well, you get up, and then you go out the back door, and then you make a right, and you go down to the first road you come to, and you make a right, and those are all words. I could visualize it, but I'm likely to just say it. And one of my greatest fears is one day I'll get so old I'll forget to monitor my private speech, right? You know, you ever just be talking out loud and people are like, what are you talking about? You're like, oh, I'm just talking to myself. Maybe I'll forget to monitor that. Because the thoughts that go through people's minds are amazing. Not always appropriate, right? So we learn to do what? Censor our speech. We say things under our breath if we think that that's something that's not appropriate to say. But we say it either out loud or mentally. I was thinking the same thing when you said that. What do you mean? I'm thinking in speech. The speech that you just admitted was very similar to the speech-based thought I was having at that moment. Now speech and activity merge, and we've got advanced cognition. Now I have the ability to conceptualize possibilities and then act upon those conceptualizations and try them out and see whether or not my hypotheses about the world are correct or incorrect or need to be modified or et cetera, et cetera. Here, cultural context gives you the world meaning. You've got the self. The self is in a way a world unto itself, but the self develops initially embedded in a family, and that family is embedded in a community and has friends or other family, extended family, school, work, employment, which happens within the context of a culture, which then happens within context of the world. We have more information about the world as a whole now than we ever have in the history of humanity. But we're still embedded in our own cultures. We still grow up within a subculture, and that gives us perspective. There's nothing wrong with that. That's normal, it's natural, but it does lead one to a rather limited view of all the possible interpretations of reality, all the possible interpretations of politics, all the possible interpretations of religion, all the possible interpretations of things like sex or race or gender or socioeconomic status, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you have a position you come from, and now you have the ability to make meaning happen for yourself. His system really advocates, and here's a term, thanks for y'all coming today, scaffolding that you might want to know for your test. Interdependent learning, guided learning. Much learning occurs in our current school systems where kids sit in a set of rows facing the front, and the person up front tells them things that they passively receive, and you hope that they remember, but that only matters if they're paying attention, right? What do they learn how to do? Just like you, they learn how to look like they're paying attention, right? Everybody paying attention. No, everybody ain't paying attention, but they are now, by God. That's called a startle reflex, and you don't have to learn it. We'll see in Pavlov, that's an inborn reflex, but guess what? Attention goes up, attention goes down. So in an active system, you're actually working with the kid one-on-one, particularly with things that they're already interested in, so you want to capitalize it. Maybe you've heard of the Montessori school system. Right, Maria Montessori, who developed an active means of teaching young children particularly, where you're working with them on activities. But scaffolding says that you don't do the activities for the kid, you give them the basic principles and allow them to try them out. And you don't necessarily go, no, that's wrong. You don't give immediate corrective feedback, you allow them to work through issues where they then are engaging in their own meaning making. And if they ask you for help, you're right there to support them like a scaffold, right? So you're supporting them as they get to the next level, and then when they achieve the next level, you let them be and move to the next set of learning that you want to accomplish. So the idea of scaffolding isn't that you do everything for them or that you withhold everything from them, but somewhere in the middle where each individual child would be looked at individually as to their own interests, their own abilities versus what the society or the school wants them to learn and the best means for them to achieve that learning in a way that really is active and very much in line with Vygotsky's sociocultural theory of development.